In February 1991, Malaysian Prime Minister Dr. Mahathir Mohamad unveiled his vision to turn Malaysia into a fully developed nation by 2020. The idea, which came to be known as Wawasan 2020, or Vision 2020, listed 9 strategic challenges the country had to overcome to reach the goal of a united, progressive, and prosperous nation.
The 9 points under 2020 had helped the government to industrialize. When we started off in 1957, the GDP was not even worthy of mentioning in modern days. But now you have got around, let's say, $9,900 at per capita income.
It was refreshing to read such liberating words like a united Malaysian nation, common and shared destiny, and one bangsa Malaysia in Wawasan 2020, and the 9 strategic challenges.
But today, almost 30 years after Dr. Mahathir first mooted the idea, Malaysia is still falling behind its 2020 vision quest.
This is not a complete failure. It's just we didn't make, and we failed about 5 years to make that developed status.
Why has Malaysia failed to achieve its much-touted 2020 vision? What will it take for this resource-rich nation to reach this lofty goal? A historic moment for many Malaysians. It was the year when Dr. Mahathir Mohamad put Malaysia on the road to industrialization with the launch of Malaysia's first national car project, Proton. His idea was to pioneer Malaysia's industrial and automotive revolution, help raise the nation's engineering capabilities, and boost its growth. 29-year-old leather bag maker Mohamad Sholihin Mohamad Zaini and his father are proud owners of Proton cars. Owning a national car was a dream come true for them. In fact, his father bought the first generation of Proton cars, known as Proton Saga, which was manufactured based on a joint venture between Heavy Industries Corporation of Malaysia Berhad, or HICOM, and Mitsubishi. Sholihin still remembers watching the replay of the historic announcement on television when the Malaysian first national car was revealed to the public.
Kita pun rasa bangga sebab ini adalah first Proton National kita. Jadi waktu saya tak sempat rasa Proton Saga, tapi saya dapat yang second generation lah, Proton Wira. Waktu tu pun saya masih bersekolah lagi. Cuma perasaan bangga tu bila saya tahu ayah saya beli kereta tu dan dia bawa balik dan setiap pagi dia hantar saya ke sekolah dengan kereta tu, memang perasaan bangga tu orang cakap memang rasa dia punya lah. Sebab kita bukan bangga sebab kita dapat naik kereta, tak. Sebab kita rasa bangga sebab ini kereta Malaysia.
The launch of Proton was seen as a historic moment for many Malaysians. It was a turning point in the country's transformation from an agriculture-based economy into a modern, industrialized nation. After Proton, Dr. Mahathir became increasingly associated with many other mega projects. Among them, the North-South Highway, the Kuala Lumpur International Airport, Petronas Twin Towers, Putrajaya, and the Multimedia Super Corridor projects. These were seen as part of the nation's efforts to propel Malaysia into the industrial age, transform the physical infrastructure of the country, and provide a catalyst for rapid growth. All these projects were also sparked by Dr. Mahathir's vision to turn Malaysia into a developed nation by 2020, or better known as Vision 2020.
It was kind of telling that during that period, growth seems to be limitless. And it was generally a time where people felt rising prosperity, jobs were plentiful, incomes were rising, etc. So it was a feel-good era of the past.
Dr. Rais Yatim had served as a minister under Dr. Mahathir in the late 80s, as well as two prime ministers after him. He feels that the vision was motivated by Dr. Mahathir's strong belief that Malaysia has what it takes to rise up to the challenge and achieve an equal standing with many other developed nations.
Well, he, as a thinking man, as a man who wrote Malay Dilemma, he wants to bring forward Malaysia onto a pedestal of developed nation. He had been to Europe, to America, to England, to Japan, to Korea, and more to Japan. So what he saw was Malaysia should be having at least a segment of what Japan has, a very sure-footed way of implanting local wisdom into practice.
Apart from achieving its economic objectives, other observers see the vision as a way to unite the disparate ethnic groups in the country, to rise above racial politics and work towards a common goal of bringing Malaysia into a new phase of development.
Generally, yes, economically, you can argue that the government has achieved some of its targets. The more sizable middle class now. We saw rapid urbanization in the late 90s, mid-90s to early 2000s. I think on the political front, we are not there yet. Or on the social front, it's still, you can argue it's still not achieved. It's one of its main objectives of creating a united Malaysian race.
Seventy-year-old pensioner Gan Chee Kwan was a young civil servant in the Education Ministry when Vision 2020 was first introduced in February 1991. The Johor native, who is now living in Ipoh with his wife, says he was inspired by the vision and was very hopeful and confident about the nation's future at the time.
I was very excited indeed. After 20 years of living under the divisive new economic policy, it was refreshing to read such liberating words like a united Malaysian nation, common and shared destiny, and one bangsa Malaysia in Wawasan 2020 and the nine strategic challenges. Wawasan 2020 is a Malaysian dream, and in tandem with that, Malaysians are to become more open-minded and cultured and have positive values as citizens of an advanced nation. I was a relatively young man then, in 1991, and I thought it is a dream worth growing old for.
That vision had also inspired a generation of Malaysians. 31-year-old Amir Hadi Azmi is a freelance reporter from Alostar, Kedah, which is also Dr. Mahathir's hometown. He remembers very clearly, as a student in Kedah, how he used to engage in school activities that revolved around the 2020 vision.
I think that's the first thing I remember going to school, because it was a big deal in school. I remember all the school assignments will be on Wawasan 2020. Teachers would be like asking you to write an essay about life in Malaysia in the year 2020. Malaysia in the early 90s was so very different, and we were doing very well economically, and every few months there would be new achievement, first Malaysian on the Everest, first Malaysian circumventing the world, first Malaysian here, first Malaysian there. So it's almost the same that nothing is impossible, and Vision 2020 is definitely going to happen.
Back then, many Malaysians also saw the rapid transformation of the country's physical landscape with the developments of the iconic Petronas Twin Towers, the KL International Airport, and the gleaming new federal capital, Putrajaya. Malaysia at the time seemed on track to become a developed country as envisioned by Dr. Mahathir. The annual growth domestic product, or GDP, was at its peak in the early 1980s through the mid-1990s, averaging at almost 8% every year.
The government and various other sectors in society, they have succeeded in transforming the nation. From, well, basically in the 80s, it was still a country that had a very strong agricultural orientation. And today, if you look at the economic orientation of the country, it is more orientated towards services. And it has got an industrial base. It has also got a very important agricultural component. So it's a much more diverse economy that has emerged. And that, I think, is an achievement. In general terms, one can argue that the Mahathir leadership succeeded in building up the nation's infrastructure.
I think mega projects were the in thing, right? And rather than sort of looking at the nitty-gritty details of household livelihood, etc., you build something, and the motto probably build it and they will come. I think in the sense that, you know, FDI was in it rushing in, there's plenty of money to be spread around.
But Malaysia's economic miracle and the long period of remarkable growth came to an abrupt end in 1997 when a financial crisis hit the region. It caught the region, including Malaysia, off guard. How did the regional economic meltdown affect Malaysia's 2020 vision?
The regional financial crisis.
The Thai Central Bank has announced it's scrapping its pegged exchange rate system in favor of a managed float. That sends shockwaves through Asian currency markets.
Jakarta would continue negotiations with the IMF.
The past months have taught Southeast Asia some sobering economic lessons.
1997 was the beginning of a painful and unsettling period for many countries in Asia. A financial disaster hit the region, and the impact sent shockwaves around the world. The crisis began with the collapse of the Thai baht. It then created a contagion that spread rapidly to other countries in Asia, including Indonesia, South Korea, and Malaysia. The economies of these countries went into a free fall as a result of the currency crisis. Malaysia's economic boom came to a halt. The Kuala Lumpur Stock Exchange lost more than half of its value following the capital flight from the country. Its currency, the ringgit, came under heavy speculative attacks, and the value depreciated by almost 50% against the US dollar. The country's GDP growth slipped into negative territory, and the economy across all sectors went into severe contractions. Thousands of jobs were lost in the process.
It was a scary period. GDP growth, I believe, declined by 6-7% in 98 alone. And the financing became scarce. You just simply don't have enough foreign investors to come in and get to pump in the money in the region, including into Malaysia. And also the realization that we probably have been living somewhat beyond our means.
Amir Hadi's father was among those who were affected by the crisis. He was then working as a manager with British Aerospace. But everything went topsy-turvy when the currency crisis hit the region.
My father, he lost his job because of that. He was working for British Aerospace. It was a really cushy job. He was bringing home about 15,000 ringgit in 1990s value, which is like a lot. And he was unemployed for, I think, 1-2 years. So he was burning through his savings. So it was, yeah, it was quite bad for everyone. We could see like all this development boom in the early 90s suddenly grinding to a halt. Like there's a few buildings still in KL that are abandoned directly because of the 1997 crisis. Until now, it's still an empty shell. So, yeah, it's a visible reminder to some of us who've lived through it.
The crisis also led to the political fallout between Prime Minister Dr. Mahathir Mohamad and his deputy Anwar Ibrahim, following months of economic policy differences on how best to manage and resolve the crisis. While Mr. Anwar opted for high interest rates and strong austerity measures to control Malaysia's sliding currency, the Prime Minister wanted greater government spending and lower rates to help revive the economy.
Yeah, in many ways, you know, Anwar's approach, if he had a chance to carry it out, would have been a lot more so-called orthodox, in the sense that, you know, to battle crisis, the IMF prescription, for instance, would have been, you know, raise interest rates, cut down government debt, and then clean up the house, do structural reforms. The key plank of Mahathir's policy was to close up capital outflow, just so that money doesn't rush offshore, and then we continue to be able to peg the currency at 3.8 to dollar at that point to achieve some kind of stability, so that corporations were running up huge debt in dollar terms were not, you know, failing left, right, center. So definitely a very, very different approach.
Malaysia's sacked Deputy Prime Minister appeared in court again today to face a fresh charge.
The differences proved irreconcilable. On Wednesday, the 2nd of September 1998, Mr. Anwar was stripped from his post as Finance Minister and sacked from the ruling party UMNO. He was later found guilty and sentenced to 9 years jail for corruption and sexual misconduct. But just a day earlier, Dr. Mahathir imposed sweeping capital control measures to shield the ringgit from speculative attacks. The move helped stabilize the ringgit. It was only in the year 2000 when the Malaysian economy began to recover from the crisis. In July 2003, Dr. Mahathir resigned from his post as Prime Minister and was replaced by Mr. Abdullah Ahmad Badawi. But after 6 years in power, Mr. Abdullah fell out of favor with Dr. Mahathir and was succeeded by Mr. Najib Razak. Although the economy has fully recovered from the 1997 Asian financial crisis and the 2008 global financial meltdown, growth failed to reach the pre-crisis levels. And that had a deep negative impact on Dr. Mahathir's 2020 vision. From a high of 8%, growth hovers between 5 and 5.5% annually until today.
It definitely distracted a lot of people, you know, leaders. I think if you remember, the East Asian financial crisis led to a major political crisis that we are still trying to deal with 20 years later. So the two crises, they're definitely major distraction. And similarly, the global financial crisis in 2009, 2008, 2009 also led to a change of leadership. So these were definitely distractions in achieving Vision 2020.
Dr. Mahathir, who returned as Prime Minister of a new Pakatan Harapan government, admitted the failure of achieving Vision 2020. He, however, blamed the two Prime Ministers for not putting the right policies for Malaysia to become a developed nation.
Well, they must take some of the blame, because perhaps they didn't have the same commitment to their vision. But I don't think it is fair to put the blame entirely on those leaders. Because if you look at what had really happened, a thing like strategic challenge number 4, ethical and moral society, we could see the negative signs even when he was Prime Minister. Was he fighting corruption the way he should have fought corruption? Was power and position more important than fighting corruption? In other words, no, he may have been a person who is above board, but he was not averse to allowing people who are corrupt to flourish.
In recent years, the oil price slump and the global trade war have also dealt a severe blow to the economy. Many say that the era of high growth is over. So will Malaysia achieve a growth rate needed to sustain its dream of being a developed nation? Can its people see the days of high income that is also equitable across the different races and classes?
Well, I think if we just like look very simplistically at the income, you know, some people have said that we need a 7% growth to achieve that. I think that looks a bit out of hand, unfortunately. I think even China's having an issue on that. So I think there needs to be a bit more of a major retooling and maybe a refocus on that sort of issue on incomes.
If that's the case, is the goal still within reach? Does Malaysia today have all the right ingredients to achieve a developed nation status? One key objective of the 2020 vision is to create a united Malaysian society. But 30 years on, Malaysia remains deeply divided along racial lines. The 1997-98 Asian financial crisis and the 2008 global financial meltdown had not only derailed the nation's sprint towards achieving its 2020 vision, it had also weakened the government's efforts and resolve to bridge the country's ethnic divide. Former Prime Minister Abdullah Badawi tried but failed in his attempt to achieve the vision, as shown by Barisan Nasional's poor showing in the 2008 general election. The then ruling Barisan Nasional lost its customary two-thirds parliamentary majority, as well as five states in the election. His successor, Najib Razak, attempted to regain the initiative through his One Malaysia slogan. But he appeared to have abandoned the idea after non-Malay voters withdrew their support for the coalition yet again in the 2013 general election.
It was a series of discontentment, but I think one of the main issues was probably religion and religious rights. I think for the first time, non-Muslims were feeling that, you see, their rights were being at least trampled, you know, to a certain extent. Whereas before, under the previous regimes or previous governments, there was a lot of compromise. But somehow or other, in my own studies, I felt that during the Abdullah Badawi era, a lot more religious issues came out. This is largely because Islamic religious elites have become a bit more established and they were already in very important positions within the government, as well as having a very strong civil society movement, see, among themselves. So that's why there was more assertion on the Islamic front, right? And because there was more of that assertiveness, the non-Malays actually felt it.
Retiree Gan Chi Kwan had a long career in the education ministry. Until today, he thinks that Malaysia will not progress if it continues to rely on its race-based policies as its main governing philosophy. Race, he feels, is an issue that can easily be manipulated by politicians for their own personal gains. And that makes it harder for the nation to move away from race-based politics.
I think it's difficult for the country to really move with this race-based, because now politicians, they all depend on all this race-based rhetorics, actually, to survive and to win votes. So it becomes a necessity, actually, to have this sort of race-based policies for certain politician or for certain political party to survive. So I think it's not good for the country.
Some observers say the affirmative action policies based on race started off with good intentions. The idea then was to help lift the socio-economic position of the Malays to be on par with other races. And the result is quite evident today, decades after it was first introduced in 1971.
If you look at the situation in 1970, for instance, you look at the percentage of Malays in the professions. We are talking of medicine, law, accountancy, architecture, engineering, you know, professions of that sort. It was very small, actually. On the average, maybe between 5% and 7% in all these professions. But today, you find that if you look at all these professions, especially if you look at medicine, it is quite remarkable that perhaps 38-40% of our doctors are Malays today. And you find that some of the best specialists in all those areas within medicine are actually from the Malay community. So that, to my mind, is a great achievement, given that, you know, to become a specialist in one of the sub-disciplines in healthcare and medicine, it is something that one can be proud of. Yeah? So there has been a transformation of that sort.
The special privileges accorded to the country's Bhumiputra community, however, were meant to last for only 20 years. The policies have continued to this day in varying forms, and that has caused a lot of unease among the non-Malays.
All the time the implementation is not focused on the eradication of poverty irrespective of race, but every time it's on a race-based policy. So actually a policy can be well thought out and well formulated, but the implementation sometimes by over-zealous officials can go the other way.
The politicians, the leadership, I think do not have enough political will to move away from the race-based politics. If you remember, I think UMNO's politics, speeches at the assembly, General Assembly, year after year became more racialized every year. And the youth chief then, Hishamuddin Hussein, chose a Malay dagger to symbolize Malay leadership, which was, I think other races found it unacceptable. So that was the start of more racialized UMNO, when the concept of Bangsa Malaysia was abandoned by the party that started in 1991. I think for a country to move forward, for the people to move forward together, they first have to have a common goal, common objective, common identity, which is what is lacking in Malaysia. What is lacking is, I think people generally identify themselves as ethnic Chinese first or ethnic Malay first, before they could call themselves Malaysian. So that is a major obstacle.
Malaysia owes its origins in Genesis to communal politics. You cannot get away from it. Merdeka was achieved by UMNO's main struggle, assisted of course by Tan Cheng Lock, by Srinivasagam and the rest. Can we do without it? Yes, we can, but not in this generation.
Hannah Yeo is Deputy Minister of Women, Family and Community Development in the new Pakatan Harapan government. Hannah, who is married to an ethnic Indian, dreams of one day when her children can declare themselves as Malaysians first, rather than Chinese or Indian.
I grew up in Sekolah Kebangsaan, and I grew up with friends of different races. And when I married a Malaysian Indian, and when I had my first child, my husband and I felt that, you know, we need to go and register the child as Malaysian, not defined by race, because she's of you know, mixed races, and also we want our child to start looking at issues no longer from the perspective of race. I mean, the baggage that we have in our generation and the generation before should not be carried by the generation to come. So I felt it was very unfair for the next generation to inherit that. And if there's something that I can do now, you know, I should do it.
Hannah believes that the battle towards eliminating racism and discrimination in the country should continue in spite of all the challenges faced by the government so far. She feels that's what the nation really wants.
They just want a fair opportunity to bid for a contract or to be enrolled into university, I don't think people are asking for a lot of things, and I don't think they're asking for drastic changes. They just want to be treated fairly. And so if the leadership is fair and we are able to explain policies and resources based on needs, I think generally Malaysians will feel that we are on the right track. I don't believe that the last election people expected a 360 degree turn, but they do want to feel respected. The voters want to feel that there must be a difference in this batch of leaders compared to the last, how they treat Malaysians. And we are not just talking about Malay, Chinese, Indian, we are talking about Sarawak and Sabah being treated equally too.
But growing pressures from the Malays of late have made it harder for the new government to fulfill its election promises. According to a recent survey done by independent pollster the Merdeka Center, 61% of those surveyed believed that the country is headed in the wrong direction. And they include the Malays who were largely critical of the government over the perceived erosion of Malay rights and privileges. Even the non-Malays have grown impatient with the government over its inability to fulfil its promises. Pakatan's major loss in the Tanjung Piai election in 2019 was the latest in a string of by-election defeats by Pakatan Harapan candidates last year. Non-Malay voters swung overwhelmingly towards the MCA candidate, which campaigned under the former ruling Barisan Nasional banner.
I think Pakatan has set the people's expectation very, very high. It's obviously, in the current political climate, it's obviously not realistic to move away from race-based politics. Having said that, the Prime Minister did that in 1991 when he was facing the most credible challenge from an all-Malay opposition front led by Semangat 46 and PAS. His response to a more Malay-centric opposition politics at that time was Bangsa Malaysia Vision 2020. So unfortunately, the current leadership, or maybe the Prime Minister, does not have similar powers or similar influence to seize the narrative and try to move away from race-based politics like what he did in 1991.
Pakatan failed to mobilize Chinese support. 42% of the electorate is Chinese. Because on the basis of the 2018 general election, Pakatan may have obtained anywhere between 85% to 90% of the Chinese vote in Tanjung Piai. And that's the reason why they were assured of that seat. Yeah? So the Malay votes that they got was sort of a bonus. But this time, the Malay votes didn't increase very much. As far as the Chinese vote was concerned, for Pakatan, it declined considerably. It was a huge fall as far as the Chinese vote is concerned.
But economic advisor to the Prime Minister, Dr. Muhammad Abdul Khalid, says it's not a zero-sum game and that both race and needs-based policies can complement each other and be used interchangeably.
There's a debate that one should only focus on need-based, not on race-based. It's not a replacement. Need-based and race-based are complements to each other. There are times you use race-based, there are times you use income-based, there are times you use geography, there are times you use gender-based. Depends on the solution that you want to solve.
Almost 30 years after Malaysia's Vision 2020 was first announced, the nation remains polarized on the basis of race. So will Malaysia be able to arrive at the idea of Bangsa Malaysia or a Malaysian race in years to come? Or will the rise of identity politics threaten to widen the country's racial divide? Dr. Mahathir Mohamad is often linked to several mega projects when he was Prime Minister of the country for more than two decades. The launch of these projects was made possible by the economic boom of the early 1980s through the mid-1990s. But the era of high growth came to a halt at the onset of the 1997 Asian financial crisis, and that had severely affected the government's ability to reach its 2020 targets. Malaysians like Sholehin, for one, feel that Malaysia, at its current state, will not be able to achieve its Vision 2020, largely because of its own economic limitations.
Sebab kalau kita tengok sekarang, masih banyak lagi yang perlu diperbetulkan. Kalau saya dapat lihat, kalau waktu sekarang ni, kenapa susah nak capai, maksudnya belum capai wawasan 2020, sebab Malaysia masih perlu banyak pembaruan dan pembetulan dari segi ekonomi, stabilan ekonomi, dan kita perlu achieve benda tu dulu, baru kita dapat mencapai wawasan 2020.
Reduction of poverty, not just absolute poverty, but relative poverty, kind of making sure that the inequality gap is closed, is narrowed, making sure that youth have jobs and employment. You see, those are the things that matters, you see, to people at the end of the day. So it doesn't matter what name or what policy, you know, you call it, as long as you achieve the results. And I must say that on that score, the government is not succeeding very well, because the messaging is very confusing, and you have a bit of the oil, you see, being retained without any alternative or substitute, you know, to some of those old policies. So that is a real issue here.
Dr. Mahathir, who's in his second stint as Prime Minister, hasn't abandoned Vision 2020, but he has introduced a set of new goals and a new vision for the country known as the Shared Prosperity Vision 2030. But instead of reaching for grandeur, as enshrined in its 2020 vision, the focus this time around is more down to earth. One of the key objectives is to reduce income inequality, close the gap between the rich and the poor, and achieve balanced growth. It's a tacit admission that the explosive economic expansion before the 1997-98 crisis is as good as gone forever.
I don't think the SPV is a vision which could be equated to the Vision 2020. The SPV is really a plan or a program to resolve certain crucial recurring problems in society. So there's a difference between a vision and a mission. I think that's very standard. You could call that the SPV is a mission rather than a vision, because it's there to solve problems, right? Like poverty, inequality, closing the income gap, jump-starting the economy, getting it back to the, you know, level that it was used before, and moving on. It's a very short-term, I think, mission. Perhaps that's better as a plan in which you can base on something that can be implemented.
Minister Khalid Abdul Samad says the emphasis on shared prosperity is imperative if Malaysia wants to continue to grow and prosper.
The new concept of the shared prosperity is one which gives emphasis to the question of ensuring a more balanced distribution of wealth, because we cannot deny that the wealth has been generated, yeah, since the 90s. Malaysia is obviously a lot richer, but the wealth is not being felt by everyone. So, I mean, to coin or to use the phrase which is being popularized by our Malaysian Institute of Planners, which is more on town planning and development for towns, they use the phrase no one is to be left behind. Yeah? No one is left behind. So whenever we do our development programs, projects and so on and so forth, we must make sure as far as possible that the maximum number of people will benefit, and the common man in the street will feel the benefits of the development and the growth.
the objective still we want to be a developed nation, which is the same as Vision 2020. It also talks about being a dignified, unified Malaysia, which is the first aim of Vision 2020, a Bangsa Malaysia. It's not different. I would agree with you. It's almost a continuation of Vision 2020, but with stronger focus or equal focus, not just on developed or unified Malaysia, but equitable Malaysia, inclusive Malaysia, that everyone benefit.
Over the last 50 years, the government policy has been focused on improving the economic status of the Malays against the economically advanced ethnic Chinese minority, which enjoys a greater share of the nation's wealth. And various attempts at softening the affirmative action policy have had little impact due to fears over a possible backlash from Malay voters. The Shared Prosperity Vision 2030 has also failed to re-energize the issue in any significant way.
It is an implicit kind of acceptance that some things need to stay, particularly when it comes to kind of protecting, you know, Bumiputra or Malay rights. Some of that has been chipped away a little bit, but not to a large extent. I think what's important is at the psychological level. I think each government must not give the impression that Malay rights are being taken away. Although at the practical level, I don't think it's just as aggressive as it was before. But that's largely also because a lot more Malays had come up. A lot more Malays had received higher education, which they didn't receive before. A lot more Malays are in the urban centres. And the middle class among the Malays has also kind of expanded. So to a certain extent, that has kind of acted as a moderating force, you see, against kind of implementing affirmative action policy fully and more extensively. So it's at psychological level, yes, every leader knows that you cannot just say, we are going to do away with it. Although quietly, in practice, you can kind of reduce it, you know, step by step.
So there are times you use race-based, there are times you use need-based. To eliminate race-based policy, ironically, you have to do it very, very well. It has to be really race. So in the long run, you don't need race-based policy. We will be in denial if we say we don't need race-based. The import is very important to still use race-based, but it must be very selective.
Malaysians like Gan Chi Kwan says that Malaysia has embarked on many plans in the past, but none have fully succeeded in achieving its desired goals.
Because there have been so many false starts. And we are doing the same things. We are all doing the same things every time, and we are expecting different results. And actually, Albert Einstein defined insanity as doing the same thing repeatedly, keep on repeating the same thing, but expecting different results. So I don't expect that this time, by doing the same thing, we'll get a different result. Probably for 10 years, the next 10 years, I don't think anything will really happen.
Unless you put it into constitutional or legal form, it will not work that well. Policy alone is not enough. Therefore, this 2030 shared future is good on the earlobe, but it may not succeed after Mahathir is no longer in that chair. Now, this is a very frank statement I make, having served the country 45 years and having seen prime ministers coming and going and having served five of them. If you don't pass that in parliament as law, I doubt it will be achieved. Because these are whims and these are data, these are ideas that can be watered down when the next master comes in. We do not know who will be, but we will be on the watch.
So to what extent will this new Shared Prosperity Vision 2030 be able to take Malaysia on the path towards becoming a developed country? Or is the vision nothing more than an elusive dream which can never be attained?
we're going to give it our best shot. Yeah, we don't have a crystal ball to say that yes, it's going to happen, but I think what's important is that everyone chips in and gives it their best effort so that what we envisage can be achieved again.
I think given these uncertainties, policy and administration, it's kind of a weak move off the blocks, as it were. Whether they can get into a stride is remains really, people have been really hopeful on that from the election, and I think they really owe it to Malaysians.
Malaysia's Vision 2020 aims to turn the country into a united and fully developed nation. But until today, the country is still struggling to place itself among the ranks of many other developed nations, in spite of all the progress that it has made so far. The issue of race, on the other hand, continues to cast a long shadow over the country's political life. And it remains unclear if the Shared Prosperity Vision 2030 will become a key rallying point that could bring the people closer together as one united nation. Only time will tell.